It's time for another edition of Lewis at Large, 60 minutes of smart talk radio featuring guests from all walks of life in conversation with your host, Warner Lewis. So sit back and lend us your ears for the next hour. Now here with today's first guest is the host of Lewis at Large, Warner Lewis.
Well, welcome everybody to another segment of Lewis at Large. Yours truly, Warner Lewis from the flight deck. And as always, that means some smart talk radios in your future. In this segment, this is going to be a subject that we have touched on, but never really hit on directly. We're going to be talking about childbirth with a truly an American expert, Dr. Randi Epstein, author of a brand new work called Get Me Out, A History of Childbirth from the Garden of Eden to the sperm bank. She comes with tremendous qualifications. We're very pleased to have her here. She's a lecturer at Yale University, an adjunct professor at Columbia University Graduate School of Journalism. She's also worked as a medical writer. She earned a BS from the University of Pennsylvania, earned an MS from the Graduate School of Journalism at Columbia, and an MD from Yale University School of Medicine. Very pleased to have her here on this day. Dr. Epstein, how are you, my friend?
Very well, thank you. How are you?
Well, we're good here. We're actually recording this on Eclipse Day, so hopefully you and I will both survive and come out on the other side all right.
Yeah, I'm not looking up. I'm just purposely kind of looking down all day to keep myself safe. Yeah.
Okay. Well, I would think in the line of childbirth, there's a lot of looking down, so to speak, as you do work. Share with our Lewis at Large listeners, if you would, Dr. Epstein, why childbirth? Why is this, obviously, it's probably one of the most important subjects for humanity, at least, to study. But talk to us a little bit about childbirth, why the fascination with it from your point of view.
You know, my fascination didn't so much start out with childbirth, though I am fascinated with the whole miracle of baby making and sperm hitting egg and making a human out of that. But it really got started because I'm fascinated with that, what I like to think of as that gray zone of medicine, when everything is not so black and white. You have this disease, take this medicine. Really, childbirth history is a look at the culture of medicine. There's so many parts of it that there's science, here's what we have to do to make a healthy baby, and then there's the woman saying, okay, but here's what my mom told me to eat and not eat, and here's the way I want to give birth, with these drugs but not those drugs. So it gets into a lot of doctor-patient interactions.
What about, as you put this together, my sense, you are a physician, you're also a writer. Did you talk to everybody, I would assume, from deep, deep inside the medical community to midwives to everything in between? Is that correct?
I do. I visited an embryology lab, so I've watched people put little rapidly moving squiggly sperm into an egg. And I've also spoken to midwives and doulas who sit with women today as they give birth and help out. And I've most importantly spoken to women. I've spoken to women who are pregnant now, who've delivered 10 years ago, who've delivered in the 1940s. So I've talked to them about how their experience changed. So I think what I've put together is sort of a views from different perspectives of childbirth, from the inside out, or from the outside in, you could say.
What I would think there would be volumes about childbirth, but how much of it is factual, and how much of it is sort of philosophical, and how much of it is sort of maybe sort of experimental / looking forward? Have we seen tremendous, tremendous strides or changes in our view of childbirth, or has it really kind of stayed the same over the centuries?
I think we've seen tremendous strides and changes not just due to science, but changes about our cultural perception. So the science, yes, we can look at the things we've all heard about, all this new baby-making stuff and the genes and the DNA and the testing and seeing 3D babies on ultrasound. And yet so much about it is cultural. So, for instance, in colonial days, when the thinking was a woman's job is to make babies, basically that was what your goal in life was said to be. So what did you do? You gave birth, you stayed in bed for a month, and women helped you during this period, and when you weren't giving birth, you were helping another woman who stayed in bed for a month. Flash forward to the 1970s, when women started to say, wait, I need to get back to work, because my only job in life isn't making a baby, and then they got out of bed the next day. And they might have stayed home for a few days. They might have gone right back to work. But my point is, there wasn't a scientific study that said how long should women stay in bed for. This was really a cultural response. And then as soon as women were getting up and out, it was like, oh, okay, well, that makes sense medically. It's not dangerous for you, and it's not dangerous for the baby.
What about... Were there things, as you started to do research, and I'm curious again, you're a journalist, you're used to uncovering things and doing research, you also have a medical degree. Did your values, did your medical view, did your philosophical view of childbirth change dramatically as a result of some of the research you did?
In a few ways. You know, I did go into it in some ways biased or judgmental in a way. I think that one of my first questions was, when did we become such control freaks? Not the doctor part, but for the women giving birth, when did we start saying, eat this, don't eat that, and try to really control the situation? And I thought 10 years ago, 20 years ago, you know, when was it this wonderful, all-natural, we just are going to let things go the way they go? And I was shocked to find out never. You can go back in time, and there were always guidebooks. There were guide papyri. So we've always tried to figure out what can we personally do as women to try to up the odds of having a healthy baby. And I think it shows our yearning to try to do the best thing for our offspring. And that's really the goal of what we're all about, whether it's the doctor trying to help a woman deliver or whether it's the woman herself. We're all aiming for the same thing, but it goes about it going about it in different ways. And I also think I opened up to different ideas. I mean, there's women today that call themselves free birthers, and they give birth, they believe in giving birth at home, no midwife, no doctor, just in the privacy of their own home. I do still worry about that. I think that there should be someone on call just in case things go wrong. It's not the way I would want to give birth, but talking to these women, I think I developed a compassion and a sympathy, and I understand where they're coming from. I think that to some of them, maybe they've had bad experiences with the medical profession, and that's a really sad response, is to just break away altogether. But I understand where they're coming from in terms of feeling that they might be trapped into too much technology, and this is their response.
If you just joined us, yours truly, Warner Lewis, from the flight deck of Lewis at Large Radio, talking about childbirth with Dr. Randi Hutter Epstein. She's a medical journalist and author of a brand new work called Get Me Out, A History of Childbirth from the Garden of Eden to the Sperm Bank. And actually, it's not brand new, but it's sort of an update, is it not? Is this a new edition? Is that what this is?
Well, we're having a big ebook sale this week, so you can get the book really cheap. You can get the book right now if you go on Amazon for this week for only $1.99, which is cheaper than a cappuccino. At least it's cheaper than a cappuccino in New York City costs, and it lasts longer.
Well, okay, let's talk a little bit. By the way, I want to dive back into a little bit more of the physiology of childbirth as well. But let's talk a little bit about the sociology of it, and particularly as it relates to in the United States. You dial back 20 years ago, 30 years ago, 40 for sure, 1960. The mother would say, "Honey, I think it's time." Everyone, they pile into the vehicle, frantically race to the hospital. The woman is prepped for delivery while the husband sits in a waiting room reading an old beat-up copy of Field & Stream or Sports Illustrated. They come out, tell him everyone's excited. Is that kind of format still going on anywhere? And B, are the changes fundamentally with fathers more involved and involved directly in the birth and in many times in the birthing room and being a part of it and sometimes cutting the umbilical cord, et cetera, is that a good thing? And if so, do you see further social evolutions that way as well?
Well, you know, I do think it's been a huge change. I mean, just to go back to the way things were, and you're right, the men were in the waiting room smoking a cigar, having cigars to pass around. I mean, when you think about it, a lot of us grew up watching I Love Lucy, and when Lucille Ball got pregnant in 1953, she insisted on continuing to be on the air during her show Pregnant, which was considered really outlandish. She had to push for that. And when she did have the show where Lucy gives birth, I actually remember that. Ricky stayed at the Copacabana. Lucy went and gave birth in a hospital. It seems like no big deal now. It was a huge deal at the time. They had to have their script approved by a rabbi, a priest, and a minister. And they could not say the word pregnant during the episode. Lucy was expecting, and then her baby came out. So we went from this secrecy of childbirth to, yes, welcoming the dads in the birthing room. And I think it really isn't so much dads helping out, because let's face it, you're really not helping. You're usually there kind of watching or breathing or trying to help your partner relax. But men aren't, I don't know, helping is kind of, it's a nice way of putting it in some ways. But I do think it's taking the mystery out of it, and that's been the big push in terms of natural childbirth. That was one of the big aims from Elizabeth Bing, who founded Lamaze in the country, was one, yes, drug-free delivery, but her big mission was, we need to explain to couples what's going on. They should be educated. It shouldn't be this scary, secretive process. And so, yes, when you said, is this a good thing? Yeah, I think the more we know about any medical procedure, and I do think it's we're not just childbirth, but it really shows the evolution of medicine. I mean, informed consent. We have to know for everything that's going on in our bodies.
Dr. Epstein, what about, let's dive now into the medical schools, and let's talk, how are the medical schools changing, evolving in how they present material regarding to OBGYNs or just doctors in general about the process of pregnancy, childbirth itself, and again, are you seeing more and more females in this field than in the past, and if so, why? Maybe it's obvious, but maybe that may be true in all different disciplines of medicine. But overall, how are the medical schools handling this stuff?
Well, I think, yes, you're seeing from way back when, from in the early 1900s, for the most part, there were a few women, but for the most part, it was male doctors and always women giving birth, but it was men who were calling the shots and telling them what to do. And now, yes, there's many more women in medicine. That's a good thing. There's many more women who are OBGYNs and helping women go through the process. What I see at some of the medical schools I've spoken at, and I'm hoping that this is a trend, is I think and I hope we're finding more camaraderie among midwives and OBGYNs who often have different perspectives about childbirth, but I think they each have their own expertise and can help each other. And I think the more we can work with midwives, and the better and the safer it is for women. It shouldn't be there's this history that you can go back in the 1930s where doctors were bad-mouthing midwives and blaming them if anything went wrong. Even if it went wrong in the hospital, the doctors would say, well, there was probably a midwife that they went to before, and that's why something went wrong. So there's this history of sort of these turf wars over who's the expert. And I think the more we can say, let's work together, we each have different perspectives, the midwife, the nurses, the doctors, and all do this for the benefit of having a healthy baby is a good thing.
You know, again, I was having this conversation the other day with somebody. Since we've been children, basically the way they do a filling in your teeth is still the same. You still get a shot. You still get drilled on. You get your teeth filled. Okay. Is basically, though, yes, there's epidural opportunities. There's all kinds of different choices now. But isn't childbirth, is there anything that could be done to change fundamentally how childbirth happens? And that could involve, I guess, pain management at some level. It could involve more technology. It could be a different way in which children are born. Or are we will be forever, childbirth is still going to be the same process all the time.
Well, I'm kind of hoping it's the same process in the sense that there's so many mysterious things about childbirth even today. So there are some studies, but we still wonder what goes on during the process of labor, what happens in the birth canal that might be adding the extra final touches to the baby. That's why some people say, you know, maybe we shouldn't rush to too many C-sections because maybe there is something in the birth canal that's healthy for the baby, some parts of the mom's immune system. So in some ways, I think we want to tinker with it when the mother's in danger, when the baby's in danger. But when there's no danger to the mother or baby, there are just certain things that I think we have to let nature take its course. So I think, I would not want to see all surgical births because to have them timed and have babies come out a certain way. And there's just a limit to how we can alter this process that happens in a woman's uterus and has to come out through certain openings. So maybe it's just what I'm hoping is we'll learn more and more about the details of this process.
What about also, kind of along with that, is 20 years ago there began a big, big trend away from the sterile delivery rooms and more towards birthing rooms, rooms where women would not only come and be in labor, but have a birth of a child and then stay overnight in some of those same rooms. I'm sensing, or from what I've heard from younger mothers anyway, that there's a trend back to and away from those birthing rooms. Is that right or is that wrong? And what's the evolution of what the physical layout at a hospital or a medical center when a person has a child?
You know, I think a lot of this talks to the business of giving birth, and also a reaction that some doctors had to women wanting to be at home, and it all boils down to doctor-patient relationships. So I think originally when you talk about home births, I think that was a lot of women saying, I'm not getting the compassion and the care that I think I deserve during this wonderful, cherishable moment. So they were backing away from the hospital. And then I think that there were doctors, maybe for the most part, saying, no, you can have a wonderful experience in the hospital, and we have some backup in case things go wrong. And from a more cynical point of view, there might be hospitals saying, we can make more money if we sort of have, you know, the VIP lounge for some women who want to give birth in a hospital and want some special treatment and have this beautiful room. So I think part of it was the business of giving birth and making more money by putting someone, you know, in the first class section. And some of it might be women saying, I want to make this a more cherishable moment or something to remember. But I still think we're talking about a small percentage of women who can afford that when you're talking about some of the fancy rooms that are available.
You know, you touched on this earlier, and I wanted to explore it a little bit, and that is at the moment of birth or the moments just prior to the birth, are there things that happen in the birth canal, so to speak? Are there things that happen during the process that somehow aid or are very necessary to ensure a better health for the child? From what you have seen, what have we learned about the magnitude and the importance of medical care delivered at the time of birth, and are, so to speak, not necessarily the mistakes, but issues that could affect a child for the rest of their life that used to happen possibly during childbirth? Are those incidences going down as far as you know?
Oh, there's a lot of things that we've done, not so much tinkering with the process of childbirth, but being prepared in case something goes wrong. So it's amazing what now can go on when babies are born too early and what doctors can see even in utero. They're fixing heart defects on some babies before they're born. They're doing surgery in utero. Babies are born really tiny, and it's amazing the amount of care and high-tech medicine that goes on to save these lives. And we've also done things in terms of not as high tech, but one of the huge changes we saw that came about in the 1970s was testing for thyroid levels at birth. I mean, it used to be that there were children, it's not common, but in a rare case, if you have a thyroid defect and your thyroid gland is not pumping out hormones, that would lead to severe cognitive impairment that stayed with you for life, slow metabolism, and real physical problems. Now babies are tested for their thyroid hormone at birth, and if it's found that their thyroid isn't functioning, they get thyroid shots. They can have thyroid medication, and it prevents these long-lasting cognitive impairment. So there's a lot of things that you don't hear about in the news all the time because it's become almost routine, but we have done wonderful things in terms of preventing long-lasting damage and making healthy babies.
Again,
now,
go ahead. Keep going.
I was going to say, of course, there's always that tension between how much technology. So there's always going to be that debate of when do we stop? When are we doing too much?
Again, if you just joined us, Lewis at Large, Warner Lewis at the Flight Deck, and we're talking to Randi Hutter Epstein. She's a medical journalist and author of a work called Get Me Out, A History of Childbirth from the Garden of Eden to the Sperm Bank. Before she gets out of here, we'll also talk to her about some upcoming projects she's working on. Dr. Epstein, just overall, has our view of medically about childbirth, and has our view philosophically about it, what it means, has it changed at all in the research that you've done over time, or is it still, again, just sort of this wonderful, glorious occasion where a new life is brought upon us?
Oh, it's changed tremendously. When you go back in history, there was so much myth and so much guilt. I mean, I think to this day, women still feel guilty if anything goes wrong. But it used to be, if you go back into ancient times, the thought was, wow, something went wrong with your baby. You were probably thinking angry thoughts, or you weren't sleeping enough, or maybe you had too much sex during pregnancy, or maybe you didn't have enough. There was always something that you did that was at fault. I think the beauty of learning more about the science of how babies are made is that we're realizing it's not always the woman's fault. We're learning more about the exact process of sperm meets egg and seeing these cells multiply and how the baby is formed from that.
What about sort of the engineering of childbirth in terms of certain techniques to increase the chances of it being a one sex over another? Tell me about that. Where is that again? People are racing to find out that kind of information, or is that just sort of faddish from time to time?
You know, I think what I like to rejoice over is that when it comes to deadly diseases, inherited genetic problems, there are techniques that we can do to screen out, to sort of break the cycle of some bad diseases. Of course, the same processes that let us look for diseases also can help us look for the sex of the baby. So it's very hard, especially in our country, to say this is what you're allowed to do and this is what you're not allowed to do. Does it go on? Yes. Do people talk about it openly? Not really. I think that there are people that can go off and see a doctor and they know who to go to that's going to say, sure, we'll go through IVF and we'll screen these embryos and figure out which ones are the girls and which ones are the boys, and we'll make sure you get what you want. It's difficult from the outside. You know, there's this knee-jerk reaction to say, let nature play its course, and people don't have a right to do that. But on the other hand, they do have a right. It's their body, and maybe if they'd be a better parent for a boy or better parent for a girl, and that's their decision. It rubs a lot of us the wrong way, but it's out there. The technology is there, and I think it's going to be hard to stop using it when it's there for that reason.
Well, it has been with us since the beginning of time, and my guess is it will be here until the end of time, if and when that were to happen. Our guest has been Randi Hutter Epstein, again, medical journalist and author of Get Me Out, A History of Childbirth from the Garden of Eden to the Sperm Bank. Dr. Epstein, what about some new projects you're working on? Tell us about that.
My new project is hormones. So kind of related to childbirth because it takes hormones, but I take a more expansive look at the history of hormones, how we learned about them, how we've learned about, how they control just about everything, and that book is due out in May.
Okay, so we'll have that to look forward to. Should be good. Again, how can people pick up a copy of Get Me Out?
The easiest way now is to go online to either Barnes & Noble or Amazon. And again, you know, it's always, I'm a hardback reader or paperback reader, but for people that want to read on the ebook, it's only $1.99 this week. So it's a pretty good deal.
And what about, do you have a website where some of the articles and some of the material you've written are available?
Sure. It's on www.randihutterepstein.com, and I have my blog, and I have all the information about the book and some other related articles.
Okay. Well, listen, thank you so much for sharing with us, and we would love to talk to you when the new work comes out.
Great. Thanks so much.
You bet. We'll be back with more right after this on Lewis at Large.